Well, let me talk about the response to a harmonic excitation when the transients have died down. Now we'll consider the more comprehensive solution where we have transients in the response. So we'll find the transient response to harmonic excitation. Now the response is due to the steady state plus the transient. So we write here that the response x of t in the general case where transients have not died out is one component that is called particular solution in mathematics, and then we have the solution to the homogeneous solution. So this is the particular solution and the second part is the homogeneous solution. The particular solution corresponds to the steady state, the homogeneous to the initial conditions, to the transients. Okay? So we can say that the particular solution x of x, v, t is what we already found, which is an amplitude times cosine omega t minus phi. This is the steady state. Steady state response. And omega is the frequency of excitation. We'll learn how to calculate the amplitude and how to calculate the phase angle. So this is the steady state. The transient or homogeneous solution is found from free vibration analysis. Found in free vibration analysis, which we already did. We already studied free vibration analysis. Okay? Now the only thing that you need is this part, that is the transient, involves constants. So you have to calculate the constants. Okay? Now one thing to be careful is that when you calculate the constants, you have to consider the entire response, this expression, to find the constants. You shouldn't consider only this part. You shouldn't see what happens to the transient solution when t, for example, is zero. You should see what happens to the total solution, x of t. So you got to be careful how you calculate the constants. So find constants after substituting x of t in this equation. So be careful, find constants after substituting into x of t. Okay, now the transient we know that depends on zeta, the damping ratio, so we'll consider three equations. Under damped case, where zeta is less than 1, so 1, if zeta is less than 1, Well, then x of t is a1 times e to the minus zeta omega m t cosine the frequency, the damped natural frequency times t minus v1, okay? And this part is the transient, which is due to initial conditions. Okay, and then you have the other part, which is the steady state, which, as we said, is the amplitude times cosine omega of excitation times t minus phi. The two frequencies are different. This is the damped natural frequency. This is the frequency of excitation. Okay? So this is due to excitation. This is damped natural frequency. Damped natural frequency. This is frequency of excitation. Okay. So if you plot them, if you plot x of t, then you will see the superposition of two sinusoidal waves. One will be at the damped natural frequency, the second one will be at the frequency of excitation. And unless the frequencies coincide, you'll see something that is more complicated than a harmonic function with a specific frequency. Okay, so this is for an underdamped system. If the system is overdamped, what will change is the first component, the first part that is because of the initial conditions. So if zeta is greater than 1, then in that case, there will be no oscillation. You're not going to see a cosine in the first term, but rather an exponentially decaying function. So you have so notice that the first part is different because the free vibration response is different. Now we have an overdamped system and there is no oscillation. The second part is the same as in the case of an underdamped system. And if you wait long enough, the transient will die out and the two solutions will converge. The form of the solutions will converge. In the case of a critically damped system, if zeta is equal to 1, then the solution is x of t equal to c1, a constant, plus another constant c2 times t into the minus zeta omega n t. That's transient. And then you have the steady state, which is the same as before. Okay? And again, the constants will be found from the initial conditions. Again, I want to stress that when you want to find these constants, you got to impose the initial conditions to this expression. That means put t equal to 0, for example, and then you'll get an expression from which you will have one equation to find one of the constants. Then you'll take, to get another equation, then you'll take the derivative to find the velocity, and then you'll put t equal to 0 and get another equation. Okay? This is a common mistake that some students make. They find the free vibration response separately, the constants, without considering this component, which is the steady state response, and that gives you wrong values for the constants. Okay. In all cases where there is damping, which is what happens in real life, the response decays as a function of time, the transient, and you get a steady state response. So eventually, as time goes by, the response will converge to this expression, which is the steady state. So in all cases, extremely rare, or maybe impossible, the transient component decays with time. Transient component decays with time. And the response x of t will converge to x0 cosine omega t minus phi with t converging to infinity. And this is the steady state. Okay, let's do an example where we'll consider a 1 degree of freedom system, and we'll find the response to a harmonic excitation that is applied at time zero. You will see that when we do this kind of examples, they're a little bit tedious. The equations are simple, but at the same time, when we find the constants, you have to go through the algebra and be careful not to make an error. But the concept is pretty simple, just be careful with algebra. We have a system, a 1 degree of freedom system, so there is a horizontal spring K, there is a damper C, and then you have a mass M, and there is a force which is P of T, P0 cosine omega T. Okay. Some properties. Stiffness is 40 newtons per meter. That is a very soft spring. Consider that. The mass is 0.1 kilogram, a low mass. The damping coefficient is 0.20%. So we're dealing with an underdamped system. And initial conditions say that the system is at rest at time equal to zero. So no initial displacement and no initial velocity. So they are both equal to zero. Okay? And we apply a force. This is the force. We need to specify amplitude and frequency. And these are as follows. The force is, has an amplitude of 10, and also the frequency is 10 newtons. So find x of t. Okay. Well, the answer, the solution is as follows. We are going to write the equation for the response. That includes the transient. We have to be careful to use the equations for an undertamped system. And then we'll use the initial conditions to find the constants. Okay. So the equation that we are using is for an undertamped system. X of t is an amplitude A1 into the minus zeta omega n times t cosine omega d times t minus a phase angle v1. That is the transient. And then you have the harmonic response, which is an amplitude times cosine omega t minus an angle theta. Okay. Now, you may ask, why do we have a transient? The displacement is zero at time zero, and so is the velocity. So why we have to consider a transient? Well, the answer is that if you apply the force at time equal to zero and the system is at rest, it will take some time to for the response to convert to the steady state. So we have to consider the transient. So it doesn't mean that because the initial conditions are zero, there is no transient. There is actually transient in order for the response to be brought from the equilibrium, from the steady, from the equilibrium where there is no displacement, no velocity, to the steady state. Okay, so what we need to do is find all these constants. This amplitude needs to be found. The phase angles need to be found. Frequencies are, we have this frequency here. So the frequency of excitation is known, is 10 radians per second. The damped natural frequency will be found from the equations. We find the undamped natural frequency, and then the damped natural frequency. So omega n is square root of k over m, which is equal to 40 divided by 0.1 k over m. And this is 20 radians per second. That's the undamped natural frequency. Okay. The amplitude of the steady state response can be found from the equation that we wrote for the steady state response. So this is x0, v0 over k divided by square root 1 minus the frequency ratio omega over omega n squared plus 4 zeta squared omega squared over omega n squared. And let's put the numbers in the numerator. You have 10, the force amplitude, 10. You have the stiffness, which is 40 newtons per meter. So this is what we have in the numerator. And then in the denominator, we have square root of 1 minus the frequency ratio is omega over omega n. Omega n is 20. Omega is 10. So you have 1/2. That's the ratio. You have to square it. You square everything that is in the parentheses. And then you have plus 4 times 0.2 squared times 10 squared divided by 20 squared. And this is equal to 0.32 meters. Okay? So this is about 1/3 of a meter. That's the amplitude of this steady state response. Okay, the phase angle, you can find it from the equation that we have for the steady state response. So the phase angle for the steady state is inverse tangent of 20, also 2 times 0.2 times 1/2 divided by 1 minus 1/2 squared equal to 14.93 degrees, and this is 0.26 radians. Okay, so we have a phase angle. So we are done with the steady state part, the second component. Okay. Okay, let's write what we have found so far and see what is there, no, what things need to be found. We have that x of t, the displacement, is an amplitude that corresponds to the transient response times e to the minus, this is the damping, times 20 times t cosine 19.6 times t minus v1 plus 0.32 cosine 10t minus 0.26. Okay? So this is the equation, and what is missing and needs to be found are the amplitude of vibration and the phase angle. Okay? You just need these two quantities. The rest is found. Okay, how did you do that? Well, from the initial conditions. You know that the initial displacement is zero. So if you put in this equation t equal to zero, you should get zero. Okay? And then if you take the derivative, which will give you the velocity, and then you set time equal to zero, then this is also zero. So you have two equations with two unknowns, A1 and Phi1, and you'll find the response, the constants, and then you'll be able to determine completely the response and make a plot of it. Okay, so, I'll go through the calculations because sometimes there are some things that are tricky in calculating the constants. For example, if you want to find an inverse tangent, you've got to be careful to make sure that your angle is in the right quadrant. So let's start with the first condition, the first initial condition that says that at time equal to zero, the displacement is zero. Okay, if you do that at time equal to zero, then you will have that A1 times cosine phi 1, okay? So if you put here time equal to 0, this is 1, so you have A1 times cosine phi 1, this term is 0, and cosine minus phi 1 is equal to cosine phi 1, so this is how you get the first term. And then if you put time equal to 0 in this term, in the second term with the cosine, get 0.32 cosine 14.93. Okay. This is in, this is equal to minus 0.31. Okay, so this, oh, I'm sorry, yeah, this is equal to 0.31. Okay, now we have the second condition, which is for the velocity. So the velocity, if you take the derivatives of these two terms, you'll have an equation with four terms for the velocity. So the velocity will be minus A1 z omega n into the minus zeta omega n times t cosine omega dt minus P1 minus A1 into the minus zeta omega n t times omega d sine omega dt minus P1 minus x0 omega sine omega d, omega t minus phi. Okay, now if you put, this is x dot of t. This is a function of t. If you impose the condition that the velocity is 0, x dot 0 is 0, then you have this equation. Minus A1 zeta omega n cosine phi 1. The cosine function is an even function, so it doesn't matter if it is minus phi 1. That's what you get from the first term. Then you get A1 omega t sine phi 1 plus x0 omega sine phi equal to 0. Okay? And what we have to find is A1. We have to find A1. And we have to find also phi 1. We already have actually A1. Okay, and we have also then find one. So you have, if you substitute 0.31 times 0.2 times 20 plus A1 times 19.6 sine phi 1 plus 0.32 times 10 times 0.2576 equal to 0. Okay? So A sine phi 1 is minus 0.10532. Okay. So we have A sine 1, then sine phi 1. We have also found that A1 cosine phi 1 is equal to minus 0.31. Okay, so from these two equations, if you can find both A1 and the angle phi 1. Now, first we'll find the angle phi 1, we'll divide the two equations, so A1 will cancel and you'll have the tangent of phi 1. So tangent of phi 1 is equal to, and you've got to be careful here to maintain the signs. So this is minus 0.10532. That's in the numerator. And then in the denominator, you have minus 0.31. So actually, the reason I'm doing this calculation is because I want to stress that it's important to maintain the correct signs and be sure that you are in the correct quadrant. So you have the tangent of phi 1. Now, where is this angle? In what quadrant it is? Is it? Well, you have negative numbers, which means that both the x and y coordinates are negative. So if you have here the unit circle, this is the unit circle, both x and y components are negative. So you are in this quadrant, okay, in the third quadrant, where both x and y are negative. This is the y component, which is minus 0.10532. That's the one of the components. And the other one, the x component, is minus 0.31. So here we are looking for an angle that is between 180 degrees and 270, okay? And if you, this is your angle. If you calculate that, it is phi 1 equal to 198.71 degrees, okay? Which is 3.468 radians. Okay? So that's the angle. Now, what would have happened if someone who was not careful had canceled the negative signs? In that case, that person would think that the angle is in the first quadrant. So instead of this angle, which is 198, you would get another angle, which is between 0 and 90 degrees. And then the results are not right. Okay? So one of the reasons that I go through the tedium of all these calculations is just to demonstrate the importance of making sure that you are in the right quadrant. Once you have this angle, which is 100, almost 199 degrees, then you can use one of the two equations to find the amplitude. So this amplitude is 0.327. So the amplitude is 0.327. The final result is that x of t is 0.327 into the minus 4t times cosine 19.6t minus 3.468. That's the first component. The second component is 0.32 cosine 10t minus 0.26. So that's the 3 by, I'm sorry, this is the transient response. Okay? This is the part because of the initial conditions, so this is the transient, and that steady state. If you wait long enough, this component will die out, and you'll end up with only the steady state response. Okay? And again, be careful when you calculate the inverse tangent of an angle, make sure you use the correct quadrant, okay? If you use a mathematical software such as MathCAD, then there are two ways to calculate an inverse tangent. One is just to put a one number, but the correct way is to remember that the inverse tangent is a function of two numbers, not just one. It is a function of the x component, the horizontal and the vertical component. So you got to specify, there is a function where you specify both these numbers and then you get the correct quadrant. And this is what you have to use. Okay, let's see an example of the response for different initial conditions, the response of the system. What we are looking at here is the solution to the problem that we have just solved. Remember, there is a 1 degree of freedom system with some damping, and we start applying a force at time zero when the system is at rest. So no initial velocity and no initial displacement. So both are zero. So this is what we see. We have this part of the response, and the transients die out quite sooner, quite fast, as you can see. At this point, the slope of the curve is zero, but you cannot see it, it's very small. So the curve initially is horizontal, the slope is zero, and the displacement is zero, okay? And you see that there is a transient and the displacement at this point is bigger than the rest, but then after that, you only have the steady state response, which is a harmonic function. If you consider other initial conditions, let's say you have an initial displacement, which is, say, 10 centimeters, okay? But no velocity, then you start from here. You have an initial displacement, so the response is because of the initial conditions and also the applied harmonic force. Again, you see the transient, and then that dies out after maybe almost a couple of cycles. So after this point, essentially, you have only the steady state response. So this part is not a sinusoidal function. It is something that is, it is actually the superposition of two components. One is at the natural frequency of the system, the other is at the frequency of excitation, and this part that is at the natural frequency of the system dies out with time. Another example, if we make the initial displacement 0.2, then you have this type of response. Okay? So now the only difference is compared to the previous example is that we start from a displacement of 0.2 as opposed to the first place where we started at 0.1. Another case with a large displacement, let's say we have displaced the system by 0.6, okay, more than half a meter. So the system starts from this position, and then there is this transient. And again, after a couple of cycles, the vibration has died out, okay? But the transient is quite pronounced in this case. And you have two essentially vibration in two frequencies, the natural frequency of the system and the frequency of excitation, and that's why you have this kind of curve. Now, if you put in the system an initial velocity of 9 meters per hour, per second, I'm sorry, but the displacement is zero, you start from zero, but there is some overshoot because the system has a large initial velocity initially, so the displacement goes up to almost 55 centimeters, or something, yeah, about 55 centimeters. It oscillates, and then again the oscillation, because of the initial conditions, dies out. Okay, so if you write a program, you'll be able to compute the frequency response and consider the initial conditions appropriately. Okay, so with that we close the part on response to harmonic excitation, considering both harmonic, both steady state and transient response. Now the next step is to consider periodic response. Conceptually, this is not a significant challenge. So response to periodic excitation response, how to calculate the response to harmonic excitation, then it is easy to extend what we learn to a periodic excitation. Why? Because any periodic excitation can be written as a superposition of harmonic excitations. So Even if you have a periodic wave, you can break it down into several sinusoidal waves. And we already know how to find the response to the sinusoidal waves. So we take advantage of the linearity of the system. We find the individual responses to every harmonic. We add them up and we find the response. Okay. So if the force is periodic, then this means that after a period, the function repeats itself. So if the response is P of t, then if you wait for a period, you'll find this, and you calculate the response, you'll find the same value. And this is true for any time t. Here is a plot of the function. The function looks something like this. Okay, this is just one period. If you look at the next period, it's the same function. It just repeats itself. And so on. Okay? Get this kind of a double peak. And then continues. Let's extend a little bit the time scale. This is t. So the period can be from this point to this point. This is the period t. Okay, so we have the same thing repeated. Okay. The idea is to use a superposition principle to decompose this function into a sum of harmonic functions. You find the response to each of the harmonics, and then you add them up, and you find the response to this function. Decompose the excitation into a series of harmonic functions. That's the first step. Decompose excitation into a series of harmonic functions. The second step is find the response to each harmonic. And then the third step is superimpose the responses. So here is what you do to decompose a function into harmonics. You have a constant, okay, and you'll see why we write, instead of putting A0, we write A0 over 2 in a few minutes. and then you have the harmonics. That means in sum, theoretically an infinite sum of sines and cosines with the same frequencies that are multiples of a fundamental frequency. So we have the cosine term an cosine n omega t plus bn sine n omega t. So we have two terms here, sine and cosine, same frequency, okay, n omega is the frequency, and notice that the frequencies are multiples of a fundamental frequency omega. So when n is equal to 1, you have omega, then you have 2 omega, 3 omega, and so on. So if you want to write this expression, all you need to do is to find the constants, and here are the equations for the constants. An is omega over pi integral from minus half a period to half a period. The function, this function here, which you have, and then multiplied by cosine and omega t dt. That's the first constant that multiplies the cosine. The constant that multiplies the sine is omega over pi integral from minus half a period to a period d of t sine n omega t dt. So these are the constants, okay? Now, the reason that we wrote a0 over 2 is because we can use this equation even to find a0, okay? So if you put here m equal to 0, then this equation will give you a0. But then you have to divide that constant when you write the equation for the series by 2, okay? Otherwise, if we had not done that, which is not a big deal if you want to do that, all you have to do is to write another expression. If you had preferred to write a zero without two, all you have to do is to write another equation for a zero separately. So this trick here, writing a zero over two, allows us to use the same equation even for the constant. Okay, we can write this expression also for the force in terms of complex numbers. So you have a sum from n equal to 0 up to infinity of cn, this is a complex number, cosine n omega t minus phi n, okay? And you can write it also as summation of from n equal to 0 up to infinity of cn into the j n omega t, okay? And the constants are C0, A0 over 2, and Cn is a complex number. It is An minus J Bn. Okay? The magnitude of Cn, the constant, the complex constant, constant that incorporates both A and B, is square root of An squared plus Bn squared. And the phase angle is the inverse tangent of Bn over An. Okay, so once you have decomposed the excitation into sines and cosines, we find the responses separately for each component and you add them together and you are done. So the equation that you will solve is this. Mx double dot plus Cx dot plus Kx equal to the summation from 0 to infinity of Cn Ej n omega t. And the response is superposition of responses U to each harmonic component of the excitation. Okay, so with this we have completed the part of this chapter on finding the response to a periodic excitation, and the next part will be to find the response to an arbitrary excitation. That means a force which is just an arbitrary excitation. The same idea that we used before, which is the superposition principle, will be applied again. So when you have a periodic excitation, the response is the excitation is decomposed into harmonics, into sinusoidal functions. When you have an arbitrary response, excitation, then we're going to decompose the function into sum of delta functions or unit impulses. Once we find the response to each impulse, we're going to superimpose the responses. We're going to find an equation, derive an equation, a general equation, which can be used for any application that for any type of force. As long as the system is linear, this equation, which will be called convolution integral, can be used to find the response. And that will be the topic of the next class.